Okay, thank you. Welcome, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Richard Sulph from the University of Derby, as you can see. And I'm going to be challenging you with lots of questions. Because questions are interesting, they are useful, and are much more valuable than lots of answers. And I've had experience in the industry, in IT industry now, since pretty much all of my life. And I'll talk a little bit about that a bit later on. But I've been at the University of Derby working in a whole range of different fields, management and computing, and now I'm majoring in on analytics and governance. Because governance is a really important aspect of how we run our organizations, and we need to get our geeky computer science and IT students understanding that there is more than just coding and technology. That actually, all of this coding and technology, which is very valuable to the world, also needs looking after very carefully. There are a lot of questions that need to be asked about how it impacts on people and on organizations. And so that's why we actually have separate modules in our undergraduate and master's programs purely about governance of information systems and data itself. And that will form a lot of the background of what I talk about today. If any of you want to keep in touch with me in the future, if you find what I have to say interesting, you can always catch me on LinkedIn and follow what I do there, because I raise lots of questions there about a lot of things. So, leadership. In the world of IT, there are an amazing range of things that we can do. But just because we can do it does not mean that we should do it. Hence the title. Particularly in the context of finance, big data analytics, AI, and the European General Data Protection Regulation. So I'll be covering those sort of areas today. Because, as I say, we can, but really, should we be doing it? We need to ask questions. The whole of what I have to say today is about questions in this context. I want to look at, ultimately, the core behind what I have to say today is to do with ethics and governance of our big data and our analytics that we're developing rapidly. Because big data, all that data that's swilling around in our corporate systems, the stuff we hook in from outside, can have an amazingly positive transformational effect on our organizations, our businesses, our services. But, there's a big but. If we do it wrong, or we don't ask the can we but should we, or we should, can but should we, if we don't ask that question, we can get our companies into some fairly serious problems. But it can, if we do it right, deliver huge benefits. And then, what's the impact on ethics, governance, and all of these wonderful tools of the GDPR? But, as this is a leadership development session, I'll start off with a short consideration on what leadership is and where it should lead us, where it should go. I'll talk a little bit about some of the other aspects of leadership which are often forgotten. Inspiration, enthusing, trusting, empowering. And I'll do that by a little short story about my life in the last 4 years or so. Because me standing here as an academic in front of business leaders is not a usual place for academics to turn up in. It's a consequence, however, of the inspiring, the enthusing that I was given by a couple of bosses 3 or 4 years ago. And then, having covered what leadership is and given you an illustration, I'll then move into an area which is very close to what I do pretty much every day, both with students and the stuff I do out on LinkedIn in various areas. And then I want to look at this analytics governance, ethics, trust governance, thinking about the data and then analytics, and then move on to something that's really raising its head very, very rapidly, the area of AI and machine learning. Not just in the field of clever self-driving cars, but into areas, for example, like HR, where they're beginning to look at the use of HR techniques, AI techniques, to actually vet all of the applications before a human gets near them. So, managing. Managing and leadership are two valuable and important parts of running organizations. Management is typically about trying to get the task defined, resourced, and completed. But I guess most of you, if you're CFO level or thereabouts, you've got lots of people below you who are doing all of that day-to-day stuff. Your role as leaders is probably more to do with where the organization needs to go, and is it getting to that point? So, I want everybody to think about what you actually do. Are you actually, despite being called a leader, are you really spending too much of your time trying to find a sheepdog to help round up the staff to go in the kind of the right direction, get stuff done? Or are you in that mode? You know where you're going, and those of your staff and others around you, they're following you because they know where you want to go and they support that. They're like this Middle Eastern view of being a shepherd, whereas many parts of Europe, we have that view of a shepherd chasing from behind, rounding up the sheep and trying to get them somewhere else. But I like this image. It's what many of my students are doing with me. They understand where I'm going, where I'm taking them. I don't have to keep doing that all the time with them. They just do this. So what is it that are critical attributes of a leader? Well, first, you have to have a vision. You need to know what it is that you want to achieve, where you're trying to get to. Years ago, the cynics, when the management scientists came up with the idea of visions, people would cynically say, "Oh, just go take a magic mushroom and you'll have plenty of visions." That's too cynical. Because a vision actually is your picture in your head, the dream in your head of where you want to get your organization. It's the thing that helps you form strategies in the end. But it's that overarching idea, I want to be over there. And you want to get everybody behind you to come with you. To do that, you've then got to turn that vision into a passion that really fires you up with enthusiasm yourself. This is where I really, really want to get, and I want my organization to get there. You have to also be amazingly good at communication. You have to know some of the basic ground rules of communicating to an audience, so that they don't go to sleep, but so that they also are persuaded by you, they accept your ideas. That's what leadership is about. Now, there was a lovely example of what communication is not a few years ago in the British political system. A fairly senior politician had got some ideas that he believed in really passionately. And yet, when he toured the country, and talk to audiences all around the country about his ideas, they were rejected, almost without exception. And then he sat down and thought a bit about it, and then he said, actually, the problem's with the audience, they're too stupid to understand what I'm talking about. Which is not the right analysis. He, as a politician, should have known the rules of communication, which are things like, you need to understand your audience. You need to understand the position they're coming from. You need to understand the type of words and language that they use and that they are receptive to. You need to understand how to persuade people, not to call your audience stupid. He had taken the position that I got the ideas, I'm going to give them to you, and you've got to accept them. That's not the right way. The failure in communication was his, not the audience. Now, we've all been in our previous existences over the years. As junior people, we sat there and looked at our seniors who were giving us a talk about a vision for the company or a change management requirement because we need to move forward. And we've all sat there, relatively junior people, and said, yeah, we've heard that before. We don't like what you're saying. You haven't persuaded me. Communication failure is not with the audience, it is with the people who are actually saying that. People who should understand communication. The failure to communicate is always in a person communicating, never the person who's listening, the audience. You have to find, as a leader, as a communicator, the ways of persuading your people, your audience. Walking the talk, yes, of course you have to walk the talk yourself. You can't have one rule for me and one rule for somebody else, for all the others. That breeds cynicism so fast you can't imagine. If you want to be seen as the leader, you have to do the same sort of things that you're asking your people to do. You think back to times of difficulty. Now, I don't know enough about Austrian history to think of the right sort of people for you to think about as the great leaders of your country. But in England, Churchill, during the Second World War, was seen to be an amazing leader because he could understand the population. He could talk to them in a way that inspired them, enthused them to follow him, in spite of the difficulty. And he knew that he had to have courage because things were looking really difficult. Now, we don't necessarily have the same problems today, but every leader needs to have courage about their vision of change. Because often that change is something that people say, no, can't be done. We've been there, we've done that. As Niccolo Machiavelli once said many years ago in Il Principe, whenever there is a change, there are a few ardent opponents who have all the great reasons for it not working, and loads of kind of mildly accepting people who will kind of follow. But they're never enthusiastic about the change. The enthusiasm is always against change, or almost always against change. So you have to have the courage to be able to lead and get that enthusiasm for change. That's what you have to do. Change management is an incredibly difficult task. When IBM did their CRM process in the 1990s under the leadership of Lou Gerstner, it took 10 years for him to work through with all the divisions across the country, over the world, to go from one model of account management to a different one, which is much easier for businesses to work with. A single point of contact rather than an account manager in every division. 10 years of hard work, and at the end of it, only IBM North America had really bought in heart and soul to the change. All the other divisions, the staff could easily tick the right boxes in a quiz about the change management process that they had developed, the customer relationship management system that was supposed to result. But none of them, even after 10 years, heart and soul, in here, believed. They know intellectually what it was about. How many of you have been involved in big business process re-engineering projects, ERP projects? And yeah, at the end of the classic 18 months to implement SAP or JD Edwards or Oracle or PeopleSoft, yeah, they can do the button pushing, but do they really believe that there's an improvement or that the new processes do things better? We've been there, haven't we? And found it doesn't really happen in 18 months. You know, it might, after another 2 or 3 years of heavy reinforcement, get them there, mostly. But it's difficult. So you have to be doing all of those, but are they really enough? I could have found lots of more images of different factors, but the 3 or 4 that I'm interested in came out of my experiences. Started Rolls-Royce in there in 1969 as an undergrad apprentice and stayed with them for the best part of 30 odd years, 31 years. In the meantime, after a year at Rolls-Royce in Derby, I went to university for 3 years sponsored by them, and then went back and in the end eventually was involved with 2 major business process re-engineering projects before I left. And then since 2002, I've been an academic. So what happened? Now, the real important part started around about 4 years ago when the boss I had and the one below, the departmental manager, started encouraging me to do things in a different way. And the results of that have been really quite interesting. Because before that, although there were some elements of my current position, back then I was the traditional academic. I've got lots of knowledge which I've got to ram into your head students. And fortunately, as we all know, lecturing is a bit tedious. Most of it falls out of the other ear quickly. And the results, okay, my results weren't that bad. But they inspired me, but more importantly, empowered me to make this change. Basically, go do things, Richard. Try them out. See which works. If it doesn't work, okay, you've learned something, I hope. And you won't make that mistake again. I was the traditional academic as domain expert. Okay, I moved across various domains, but came back ultimately to my home one, which is this analytics side, IT. But what I was encouraged to do, and I'm now finding more and more people around the world, when I go to some academic conference on teaching and learning, more and more people are following the mode that I now use. Academic as learning to learn expert. Academic as mentor and guide. Academic as inspiring the student, not just managing them, trying to get them to turn up and do stuff, but just encouraging them to engage with the problems, finding the questions, developing some interesting answers. It turns out that acting as a mentor and guide for the developing soft skills of learning, research, critical analysis, storytelling to communicate, has very, very powerful effects in terms of getting students to actually succeed well in their studies. Whereas if you're just trying to ram the stuff in and forget about the mentoring and the inspiration side, they do averagely. So I was inspired by a real leader who didn't care much about management. Other people could do the managing. He inspired me to do something different, which leads me to become a leader of my students, not a lecturer responsible for them per se. They follow me as well in the directions that I'm inspiring them, which is a completely different way of looking at higher education from the traditional approach. And it's worked. So, can you do the same with your own teams? If you haven't done that yet, think about what you do. In some places we call it continuous professional development. Reflect on what we do and where we want to get to. The rest is more technical, is all questions, showing you where we need to ask questions about these magical capabilities that are being developed by computer scientists. Some of the stories are going to be quite skeptical. If you weren't thinking about the experience I have, you might think it's just pure cynicism. No, it's skeptical because I'm asking questions about what is being done. Whether it's about the safety of autonomous vehicles or the ethics and GDPR consequences of using machine learning and profiling in job application analysis. It's to do with a question, because under certain circumstances, it's great. But under other circumstances, it could be difficult for people, our staff, or our reputation of the company. At a senior level, at the CXO level, and higher, in section 172 of the UK Companies Act 2008, there's a section about the responsibilities of executives, that is the board members particularly, the legal board members, who have a responsibility to consider the consequences of any decision for the long term. There's a whole range. If you were a group of HR executives, I would concentrate probably on the top one or two points. I want to concentrate on the last one in our context here. A reputation, maintaining a reputation for high standards of business conduct. So let's think about a couple of examples which we have seen. One, beginning of this year, Uber. And we think back to about 10, 12, 15 years ago, Enron. Both of them were catastrophic failures of leadership of the organization. This one was rather interesting. It all blew up big time February 2017, when Travis Kalanick ended up on YouTube video, and within the same week or so, that the young lady at the bottom right, Susan Fowler, blew the whistle on the sex discrimination within the tech industry, particularly in Uber. Plus, there's a case going through the courts now in the USA between Google Waymo and Uber, where Google Waymo have accused Uber of stealing a large amount of technology IPR. And the claim is for about $2 to $3 billion compensation. I haven't got time to go into the details behind it, but if you're interested, it's quite easy to find quite a lot of content about perspectives about what Uber may or may not have thought when they gathered in or acquired this huge amount of technical knowledge from Waymo. As a result of that, Travis Kalanick is now no longer CEO. He's not even on the board, even though he owns most of the shares. And it came also from the pervasive perspective about it from the technology companies, particularly those who call themselves platforms like Uber. They're not a taxi company, they just provide a mechanism to connect you and me to taxis who who happen to use this booking system. So they're not relevant or not affected by the laws of the land in all the countries in which they operate, so they claim. They like to think of themselves at least above the spirit of the law, if not the letter of the law. And it led up to 4 weeks ago when I was doing the same sort of presentation in Copenhagen at another management event session. That week, Transport for London had declared that Uber were no longer fit to actually operate a taxi service. So it's going through the courts, but they will be banned if it goes through, okay, from providing cars in London, as they have been in many other cities of the world. Because they believe themselves to be above the law, effectively. So there are interesting issues like that about these technology companies. It shouldn't apply to anybody in here, I guess. Because are any of you in a technology platform sort of company? Okay. But probably not with the same sort of perspective, I guess. No, that's right. So leadership can catastrophically fail and cause corporations a lot of problems. So now, here are some areas where there are some big consequences of governance and leadership. I'll start with IT projects, because we see vast numbers of IT projects in all of our organizations. And generally speaking, and I've been there before because I was involved in running projects, we like to think that our projects are going to be successful in spite of all the evidence. The evidence here is from a company called Standish Group, who work with chief information officers around the world and do an annual survey, typically about 50,000 projects, from many million pound projects down to much smaller projects. And they try to measure the success and failure characteristics. And the causes of success and failure of projects that use IT around the world. And they've been tracking the level of success and failure and challenge, as I say, since about 1994, when they issued their first so-called chaos report. When they first did it, and that's this blue line, which is a successful project, they defined it as projects which were on time, to budget, and delivered all of the contracted for functionality. And given that a lot of the projects were quite long-term ones, sort of 3-5 years, CIOs continually complained that that's not a valid metric because the world changes in 5 years. What we need to be measuring is projects that deliver value on time, to budget. So, Standish Group eventually listened, asked the questions in 2013 or thereabouts, backtracking also over the previous 2 years, to come up with on-time to budget delivering value, which is this line. Now, of course, the CIOs were expecting that delivering value was going to improve the rate of success. Only it didn't. We're still at 32% of all projects are on-time to budget value or successful. The challenge ones on time to late over budget, delivering only part of the functionality or very little value, have continued to run at the 40-45%. And then we have the failures down here. And yes, the one thing we have achieved over the last 23 years is to reduce the number of failed projects from 30% down to around about 20%. But that's only just moved up the challenge, it hasn't changed the success rates. Now part of that is because we cannot learn from the past practice. We do not share outside of the organization our failures. Unlike, for example, in the building industry or the bridging industry, if there is a catastrophic failure, like say in the 1960s when the Box Girder Bridge collapse happened in the UK, There was an immediate inquiry, a technical inquiry, and the whole industry learned how to build box girder bridges safely without them breaking. But in the world of IT, for extremely good reasons, most companies are very, very reticent to share the numbers of unsuccessful projects and the causes of those failures, other than occasionally through Standish Group chaos reports. Because if those sort of measures became clear, it would probably be quite dangerous or quite damaging to share prices. Companies can't manage their IT projects, and that could have damaging effects. So clearly we're not going to share those, it's too price sensitive. But that means that everybody around us can't learn from the lessons either. Now, think also from your experience. You go to different conferences about things, and most of the use cases or case studies that are presented are always the successful projects, aren't they? Am I right? Do you ever hear a presentation about a project that went catastrophically wrong and the reasons for it going wrong? No, so you can't learn. And in the field of big data analytics, an IBM expert was saying 2 years ago, one of the big conferences on analytics that they run annually, that back then, and I suspect it's the same today, the success rate of big data analytics projects was running at about 40%. Same as that line, roughly, a little bit better. Why aren't we learning? Why do we always assume that the next project is going to be successful? All the evidence shows that it's not going to be, so why don't we plan on the basis it might be difficult? Moving on to data. One of the things that's happening now is we're capturing more and more and more data. Huge amounts of it all over the place. And this is a very typical sort of a question. Not only is the question, we haven't got the slightest idea what to do with it, but also, does anybody around that table understand what the data means, or how accurate it is, or how biased the data is? If you're an insurance company, and you've done some analysis, got all the data about your current clients, about their profiles, about the products they've got, everything you need to know, but you've only got 5% market share. Whilst the data is perfectly, if it's accurately recorded, relates to your current clients, but you now are wanting to move into a different market sector, to grow your market. You use your magical predictive analytics technologies to analyze all of that stuff and develop a nice automated acceptance rejection technology based on your current clients. If you don't realize that that is inherently a biased environment, biased to your current clients, then when you get lots and lots and lots more applications from people who have a different profile, it's going to reject them all. Probably, because the training was biased towards your current clientele. Now, if you've got 50% market share, it may not be the same problem. You may have enough people of diverse profiles that you can apply that same machine learning module or model to the rest of the population. So you have to ask questions about your data, your training, and so on. We collect data from many, many places. Lots of things, like mobile phones, like sensors, all the other sources of data we have, and out onto the internet as well. However, all of that data is difficult, ultimately, to understand. We don't understand the accuracy of probably 80% of all the data we have. Now, when I first saw this, I thought, Enterprise data, that's 20%-ish, that must be the data that's okay. The veracity problem only applies to all the other stuff. Now, most of you have probably implemented ERP systems like SAP or Oracle, JD Edwards or something at some time in your companies, haven't you? And before you go live, you carefully data cleanse all the master data that you've got, and you probably culled 70% of all the stuff that's accreted over the last 20, 30 years. And you put 30% of the data in as the nice, clean, go-live data, don't you? Yeah. Now, I thought that when you did that, it was going to stay clean. And then I remembered that when we implemented SAP, we only implemented 20% of the functionality that our existing systems had had because, well, you use the pre-approve process on most things. It delivers 80% of the workload, so that's about right. Trouble is, the world doesn't cooperate. Them out there still have those same requirements, which now suddenly there's nothing to do in the system. Now, your staff aren't going to tell that person over there, sorry, no can do. They'll say, yes, great, we'll fix it, and we'll shoehorn the data somehow into the system, which gets dirty immediately. And 6 years later, almost everybody suddenly discovers all the master data needs re-cleansing. I see nods and grins around the place. So we don't know for sure which data in there are correct or incorrect. When we look at IoT sorts of things, it's much worse. Those Fitbits or location services on our phones, they are magically incorrect or inaccurate. As is almost every sensor system you can find out there. When the aerospace industry started extending the instrumentation on the big jets in the mid-80s, from the basic set that controlled the engine to lots of other ones that could help the airlines understand how the aircraft, the engines were working and when they needed maintenance and so on, the airlines then spent something like the next 3 or 4 years using these very expensive sets, $500,000 per engine typically was. They spent the next 3 years troubleshooting the new sensors rather than troubleshooting the engines. And I'm sure many of you have had problems with your ECU or the clever sensors on many of your cars because the sensor breaks and gives you the wrong answer. It's the sensor that's broken, not the car. A lot of irritation. Now, I came across a lot of this about four or five years ago when I took a set of photos up there at a conference, a day out, and I was taking photos of all the food. I knew exactly where I was. When I got home, back to the hotel, and connected to the internet, and Apple did its thing, it told me where the photos were taken, apparently, or at least where the tag has been taken. And those three were 22 kilometers away from where I was. Several of the photos around about that were also there. And another one was there. At which point I thought, ah, this is an interesting project. And I started getting interested in the accuracy of these gadgets. I got my students to do a whole lot of research for me to try and characterize the accuracy of locations services on their phone. Gave them a project, they ran with it. I led and inspired them. And they did some interesting stuff. Some of them found some really interesting things, like, for example, the accuracy of your smartphone location varies on a 12-minute cycle. 150 meters error, down to 10 meter error, and then back after 12 minutes to 150 meter error, and so on. Found that by accident. Going to do some more work on that this year. I also found that when you have a stationary tracker, 24 hours reading every second, out in the open, in a conservatory, you can see how far during the day that little tracker moved. I haven't actually calculated the distance that it travelled, but it's a fairly staggering distance. It's moving from there up to there, down to there is about 60 metres. The thing is, it's quite fun on that, but it has consequences, as do the fact that things like fitness trackers are magically inaccurate. They vary between each other by at least 30%. Come on to the consequences in a minute. We also get huge amounts of data coming from social media for many of our marketing and sales teams. A lot of those data are being collected to find out what people out there think about our organization, our services, our products. And people forget the lessons from Statistics 101 about getting an unbiased sample, because they've got all the data there is. Yeah, I've scraped Travelocity, I've scraped whatever. I've got every piece of data there is in the world. Surely that's enough. No. Because the people who post on these sites is an incredibly tiny, self-selected group, mostly the ones who had a really bad experience. Marketeers have known this for 30, 40 years. If I have a bad experience, I will tell at least 10 people about it. And if I have a good experience, the sort of experience I was expecting when I went to that restaurant, I probably won't even bother to tell anybody, but if I do, I'll tell 2 or 3, because it's what I was expecting. So all of those sources are stunningly biased. They do not give you, in statistics terms, the sample n equals all. They give you n equals 0.001% if you're terribly lucky. A lot of data is staggeringly biased. And that has huge consequences in making decisions for our organizations. We also have no clue what many of our algorithms are doing, particularly all of the AI machine learning algorithms. We do not actually understand how they work, period. We know how they were designed in terms of, say, the neural networks. This layer does X, an input layer. This layer does something, this layer does something, this layer does something, this layer does something. Now we stuff data, stuff in at the top, pictures or profiles, and train it, because we know that that profile equals this answer, this profile equals this answer. But when we have trained it, we do not know what it will do with this profile. There is no mechanism to do that. And here's a lovely example to do with clustering, and clustering is a fundamental aspect of predictive analytics. You do not want to, if you want to differentiate between cappuccinos and espressos, you need to make sure they're separated out, not part of the cluster equals coffee. It's a bit hilarious, but it makes an incredibly serious point about the statistics and the mathematics that underlie all of the big data analytics, AI, machine learning, and so on. Here is a question about we can, but should we? Cambridge Analytica, with a psychoprofiling of the American electorate during the Trump election. They were able to identify, on very, very small amounts of data, how people thought. And then they sent them highly individualized SMS text messages for conveying bits of message. They're now beginning to get a bit into trouble about, is this or is this not illegal political advertising? It's arguable either way, but it's going to be problematic. Target was a company that found a way of identifying pregnant women in their customer base, and then used that knowledge, once they discovered they could do it, to target women with coupons. And then the sky fell in. We also know that the recommender systems say that Amazon use aren't terribly effective. Many of the things they come up with when you log in, because it knows your profile, it knows what you've bought, and it knows what people who bought similar profiles and stuff to you bought this. Do I want that? Probably not. Sometimes it works beautifully, often it's an irritation. Fitness trackers, some very serious consequences, particularly the ones that measure your amount of exercise you've done, the target you've got of X thousand paces, or monitoring your calorific expenditure in exercise. Calorific one here is such that people are relying on this stuff, which is completely inaccurate and bogus to all intents and purposes, because they are so inaccurate. They don't adjust for your own individual metabolism rate, which varies with time. If you are starving yourself to get thinner, your metabolism actually becomes much, much more efficient, and you actually burn the calories differently. Different weights of people and so on are not built in properly. So people are now, not the professionals, but ordinary people using this to lose weight are in actual fact gaining weight because they look at it, oh, I've used 4,000 calories today and I've got a target of 2,500 so I can have a reward. And if it's calculated that wrong as a problem, if people are rewarding themselves when they're trying to lose weight, that also is wrong. The other two top ones are about health insurance, where the fitness trackers don't actually record accurately enough to actually justify the penalties that the organisations are giving. For example, the top one is about human and health insurance. If you meet this target each week, we will give you, you'll reduce your payment by £500 a year. If you miss it for a week, we will charge you a penalty of £12.50. If it's inaccurate in the favour of the company, that's good for the company, but it's ethically questionable. If I discover it and I don't do the right level of